10 seconds to answer.
It promises to be a ding-dong battle.
It's going to be one of those kind of evenings, isn't it?
We'd hate you to miss it, and you'll hate yourself if you do.
Before the late 1980s, entertainment programming in RTE was almost solely the preserve of male presenters. Theresa Lowe would change all that.
Theresa Lowe!
Join us for the first programme in a brand new season of Where in the World.
I think it was groundbreaking. The role of women was always that as the glamorous sidekick to the always male host.
For nearly a decade, Theresa Lowe presented the RTE quiz programme Where in the World, bringing charm and glamour to Sunday nights. For 7 years, she was one of the most recognised and popular presenters on television.
Tonight's teams are going to be exceptionally brilliant, aren't you?
I don't know if you can hear us.
Thanks, Ken. I'm joined now by Evelyn Cusick.
Television would also afford her the opportunity to meet the love of her life.
I actually auditioned her. I put an ad in the paper, said auditioning for Wives.
He was auditioning for me, actually.
But behind her loyalty to broadcasting lay an earlier allegiance, one that would see her swap the drama of the TV studio for the drama of the courtroom.
The first time that I addressed a jury, my voice wobbled, and it wasn't with nerves. It was pure emotion.
Dublin and Dundrum reared, but born in England in February 1963.
I came to be born in England because my parents emigrated in the 1950s with 6 children to a little place called Southam, a small little village in Warwickshire. And myself and my younger sister Mary were born over there. My dad worked in Lockheed's for a number of years, and then he was put on a 3-day week. So Ireland, my parents always wanted to go back to Ireland. They had a longing all those years. They then came back, and then eventually he ended up as postmaster in Richmond Street, which is near Camden Street. My mother was very industrious. She made all of our clothes, and everybody thought we were terribly well dressed. Everything was made by Mummy on her Singer machine.
Her school, St. Louis and Rat Mines, had a long tradition for speech and drama.
I was very involved in acting from quite a young age. There's an annual drama festival, so I got stuck in there from very early on. My very first part was Bartley in Riders to the Sea.
How are you, darling?
How are you?
All right, great fun.
Yeah, what are you?
I'm still here. You're looking brilliant.
I played Portia in The Merchant of Venice, and I think that might have been the initial spark for my interest in law. You know, the famous courtroom scene where she talks about the quality of mercy. I played Hamlet. I was offered Ophelia. I had very long hair at the time. And I turned it down. I said, no, Hamlet, he's got all the best lines.
In transition year, with journalism in mind, Theresa did work experience in the Irish press and was assigned to the forecourt, one of Ireland's most infamous trials, that of those accused of the Salons train robbery, was taking place.
I walked into Court 2, which is just off the round hall, and I saw a barrister in mid-flight. His name was Seamus Sorahan. He was in his 50s at the time, and he was addressing the jury in the Salons train robbery case. And he was just fantastic. He had the court in the palm of his hand.
But now more and more of them seem to be able to get possession of firearms.
He was, I thought, very handsome, very brilliant. And I thought to myself, at 15, this man is in his 50s, I'm going to marry him and I'm going to be a barrister.
As a teenager, Theresa took a number of part-time jobs to earn some extra pocket money. The work ranged from Radio Leinster to making ice cream in HB, to drawing sketches for a fiver a go, and to the bright lights of the Beavers Repertory Company in Dundrum.
What was great about Beavers, I mean, for a kid of 16 or 17, because it was a semi-professional rep company, if you had one line, if you had all the lines in the play, you got the exact same amount of money, which was fantastic. One year, we were paid so well, I got £80 a week for the few weeks coming up to Christmas. And it was fantastic money. I earned £28 in Radio Leinster and all of those fivers for doing the various portraits. I think I earned about £14 or £15 on the chalk ice machine.
Teresa's burning ambition to do a law degree came unstuck in the leaving certificate examination.
When I went to UCD, I had missed law by a point, but there was no question of staying back and repeating, so I just had to make the most of it. I went in and I did arts, I did English, French, Greek and Roman civilization, and I felt that there are other ways of skinning a cat and that eventually I could go back to law as a mature student, which happened, but a lot later than I had anticipated.
In UCD, her acting aspirations found an outlet in the university's dramatic society.
I really, really enjoyed Dramsoc. I got stuck in fairly quickly. I played Salome in Oscar Wilde's version of Salome. I also played Clytemnestra from Peter Schaeffer's play Agamemnon. And in fact, Agamemnon transferred to the Project Theatre, and we were all very excited. I mean, this was big stuff. And when I was there, I was offered a 9-month contract with the Project Theatre. At the same time, I was offered a contract in RTE to do continuity. I'll tell you, it was some dilemma to decide which way to go. My heart said, go with the Project, but my head said, go with RTE, because I'd have a bit more security.
So how did the offer of continuity work from RTE come about?
I was in second year in UCD. I was 19 with a brass neck like only 19-year-olds have. And I decided I wanted to do acting and I wanted to act in RTE dramas. So I walked into the drama department with 2 CVs.
The reason I got into continuity was they told me that if I did continuity, which is announcing the programmes, that I'd get an equity card out of it and then I'd get to be an actress.
At 25 to 5 this evening, there's another programme from the science fiction series Lost in Space, and it's followed at 20 past 5 by Wanderley Wagon.
They're the girls that pop up on the television between the programmes, and they're very warm and friendly and they advise what's coming next. And I said, are they the ones that come up and at the end of the night and say, Ihawa Kalasov? I said, yes, exactly. I told them, it's my lifelong ambition to be a continuity announcer. And I waited for the call from RTE. And I waited, and days passed. And then I started ringing them. And I rang, and I rang. And it was actually 9 months later they called me, and they said, you can start on Monday on your training course. And then I did my first on-air appearance the day after I completed my exams in UCD. I was shattered.
At 7:30 tonight on 2, we bring you news of this week's events in the marketplace. But right now, for those of you who've ever wondered if the living can communicate with the dead, time to find out in Arthur C. Clarke's World of Strange Powers.
While in UCD, Teresa and her band auditioned for the new talent spot on RTE's The Music Show. The programme's musical director was Frank McNamara, a regular on The Late Late Show.
Is this when you thought it was just a keyboard? It's yes. Also a drum machine.
Frank McNamara is very clever.
I remember going into the audition and I was holding the microphone and was so nervous I was nearly swallowing it. I remember this extremely annoying, bespectacled young man coming up to me and pulling the microphone away from me every 2 seconds. And I heard his name was Frank McNamara. He was the musical director. I remember going home and giving out yards about him, that this fella was so annoying. I mentioned his name and my sister Mary said, Frank McNamara, the guy that plays the piano in The Late Late Show. God, he's brilliant. I didn't know who he was at the time.
I decided then that we should have her definitely on the show. And so I was going to let that run its course. And
I never got on the show.
No, I know you didn't. Yeah, you started going out with me then.
It's that old devil called love again. Gets behind me, keeps giving me that shove again.
Frank contacted me a little while after that and said that he loved my voice and that he'd written some songs, he'd written the music, and could I write lyrics? And my neck was still brass. I said, I write lyrics all the time, which I didn't, of course. We got together, we worked for about 6 months on these songs. I hope they don't exist anymore. They were just dire. I mean, the music was great, the lyrics were awful. And 6 months later, we started dating.
Suppose I wouldn't stay, run away, wouldn't play.
When we started dating, I explained to Frank in great detail, Frank, I have a plan here. My plan is that I'm going to have a really good career. I'm going to get married at about 38 or 39. I might have one or two children then, and that's the plan. I was 20 when I met him. He said, after a few months, he said, Teresa, if you were 33, would you consider getting married? So I thought about it, and I said, maybe. He worked and worked and worked at me. I got married at 23. I was the youngest in my family.
He'll convince me that he's right again when he sings that.
Frank and Teresa were married in January 1987, with 48 family and close friends in attendance.
We had a really lovely wedding day. We had our reception in a pub. Again, the money was very tight then. My parents paid for our reception. It cost £700 at the time. Gay Byrne came to the wedding, and there were a lot of photographs taken, and photographs that ended up in the press as well. And there were so many photographs of Gay kissing me, you'd think I'd married Gay, not Frank.
He's daring, he's dashing, he's dark, he's the smouldering presence that puts joy into geography. Ladies and gentlemen, Marty Whelan!
When Marty Whelan left RTE for Century Radio, Teresa auditioned for presenter of Where in the World. Series producer at the time was Moya Doherty, later to go on to greater things with the Eurovision Song Contest and Riverdance.
She saw my audition tape and she contacted me and offered me the job. But she did say, Teresa, listen, whatever you do, don't leave continuity. This is for 1 year only. It's going to be axed after that. So just go out there and enjoy it and see what happens after that.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Welcome to Where in the World, and what a good one it promises to be.
So while I was presenting the first series of Where in the World, I was also doing nightly sessions of Iowa and Kalisov.
But none of our contestants has been to New York. That's our star prize. That's what they're playing for.
All right. We used to record 3 shows a day over 3 days. So by the end of the third day, you had forgotten your own name, never mind the contestants.
President Vigdis Finnbog's daughter was one of the first, and that's more.
She's president of Iceland.
According to St. Luke's Gospel, who was emperor when Jesus was born? Malachy Byrne.
Augustus.
Augustus is right, well done.
It was very challenging, very exciting. I always thought the contestants over the years were really lovely people.
David, will you introduce us to your friend there?
This is Ludo, Teresa.
You've met our families, the Joneses and the Collinses. And interestingly enough, John Collins, our farmer from County Cork, has never had a holiday in his life.
Now, they were called family names like the Murphys and the Connollys, but the reality is they were never related at all. Whoever was the team captain, the rest of the team took his or her name. And they were at right angles to me, the contestants. I had a little screen in front of me, and if somebody buzzed, the name would come up.
Fingers and buzzers, best of luck to you. Here we go.
I had to be very on the ball.
Who was the famous Australian artist who presented 6 paintings to Ireland on the 14th? That's Johnny Collins.
Sidney Nolan.
So Sidney Nolan's right.
It was very rapid fire. A lot of these people come from the tradition of pub quizzes, and they're excellent. They're quite often anticipating the question before you've finished it, and they're in with the answer, so you have to be sharp.
Kilmainham Jail.
It's your final chance today in the competition. We're back to £5 for correct answers, open to all fingers and buzzers. Good luck, everybody. Here we go.
I had no auto cue. For all of those shows over the 3 days, I had to write links, and I needed, for my own sake, for them to be fresh and different each time. So I was writing links, learning them off by heart.
Well done. First 2 letters in tonight's anagram coming up now, along with the scores.
And trying to smile and look as if I'm enjoying myself at the same time. It took off really instantly. We went up to 1 million viewers from time to time. It was just a fantastic rating success. There were times that we pipped Glenroe and The Late Late Show in particular. Not very often, but it was a great feeling when that did happen.
A Lingaphone language course of your choice plus the new video active tutor, 4 of them.
In its early days, the show had a reputation for its modest prizes.
I think it was in the first couple of series where they showed a shot of me at the top of the programme announcing the prizes, and I'm sitting in this very smart red car with a rug over my lap. And the viewers initially thought that the prize was the car, but it wasn't, it was the rug.
And to begin with, Paul, we're playing for some Tefal cookware with a wok for each member of the team and some cooking sauces from Knorr. What more could you ask for?
We gave away tyres, and I'd be delighted to get a set of tyres now, the price of them. That's the kind of stuff we gave away.
And then fame on the silver screen loomed momentarily.
Andy, we might be in luck, come on.
I got a call from Artie Library asking me would I give their permission to have a little clip from Where in the World on the movie that they were making called The Van. And this is based on Roddy Doyle's book. And I said, oh, that's great, and I love Roddy Doyle and I love The Van and blah, blah, blah. And I said, I'd be delighted. Artie had to ask my permission. I wouldn't get paid for showing this clip. But I said, do you know what would be lovely, though? We would love to go to the premiere, so if there was a chance of being invited to the premiere. So we weren't invited. So Frank and I went down to UCI, Blanchardstown. We sat there in the audience, and then here comes the scene.
Here we are, bang on time. Is she down there?
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Teresa Lowe.
Your woman's a fine thing, isn't she?
Hello there, and welcome to Where in the World, where two more teams are itching to do battle.
And then the other fella says, yeah, but the prizes are utter
shite.
And you're a great contestant, easy on the eye. I'm just trying to make you feel better here.
The show wasn't about the prizes. It was about the skill. It was about a bit of entertainment. It was good, clean family entertainment. And people tuned in religiously at 8 o'clock on Sunday nights to get their fix of Glenroe and Where in the World.
Before long, Teresa became a household face on RT.
Come in, Teresa Lowe! Come in, Teresa Lowe! Come.
Oh, I think she's...
Teresa, will you come... Hi!
I think now, looking back, that I felt I was in a bubble. I wasn't really conscious of people knowing me.
There's no business like show business.
Like no business I know.
I never thought of myself as a star. I always thought of me as just me. Somebody who did a professional job, and a difficult enough job to the best of my ability, and never thought of myself beyond that. It just happened to be in the public eye.
Where are you heading to tonight?
We're heading to Kinnegad. We're heading to Moat, where there's a bra stretching competition.
A bra stretching competition?
A bra stretching competition.
And are you going to contribute?
Well, I was hoping to. Oh, dear, I just made a move. Maybe.
Was it well paid? To be very honest, no. I was, I think, a step above the continuity announcer rates. I had started from a low base, so it wasn't going to get much more exciting than that. Certainly nothing like what Artie is paying nowadays. But, of course, I would have done, you know, I did a little bit on radio as well, so it wouldn't have been too bad. But I'm being honest, I wasn't paid very well.
While Where in the World was her big break, she also presented The Breakfast Club on radio with Peter Collins. Live at 3 for a short period.
I'm joined by another popular lady, Teresa Lowe.
Thanks, Derek. Well, we also welcome some of our regulars.
And Party Pieces, a children's programme that Teresa had devised.
Hi there, welcome to the first programme in a brand new series. What's it called? There, we have to leave for another season. Thank you very much.
After 9 years, the last Where in the World was broadcast in 1996. But then old loves and opportunities beyond broadcasting beckoned.
I think everything happens for a reason. And I go back to 15 years of age when all I wanted to do was to be a lawyer, to be a barrister. It took me a long time to do that, but by the time Where in the World was coming to an end, that was the year that I was called to the bar. I'd been studying since 1993 in King's Inns, did a 2-year diploma course there, got through that, and then I did the 2-year degree course. So the timing was just unbelievable. I finished up, I think, in maybe May of 97. My call to the bar was July 16th, 1997, and I started at the bar on the 1st of October. What was great for me when I was called to the bar, my parents were there, and it was a really proud moment for them. And my father unfortunately passed away 7 weeks later, very suddenly.
We're all here today in my mother's house. It's my father's 14th anniversary of his death. And always on this day, we all come to see Mummy, and it's a very special time.
He was a lovely, lovely, quiet, gentle man. He never wore his emotions on his sleeve. So I knew he was proud of me, but he mightn't have articulated it the way my mother would have, for instance.
In 1995, Teresa was pregnant with the twins Frankie and Quincy. In October of that year, Teresa went into labour at 29 weeks.
It was a huge shock, and things weren't looking good as they were born. Quincy was 2 pounds, 12 ounces, and Frankie was 3.5 pounds. That their lungs were in trouble. But funnily enough, for the first 24 hours, they started to breathe and they kept going. And then they monitored them for another 24 hours. And then they got to 72 hours without life support. And they just got such love from everybody there. And, you know, it was just, as I say, the proudest day and the happiest day of our lives, the day we brought them home from Holles Street.
You are a fast car. I've got a plan to get us out of here. Maybe we can make a deal. Maybe together we can get somewhere. Any place is better.
Teresa and Frank have four children, the twins Frankie and Quincy. Charlotte.
Everybody's got a price. I wanna have a sleep at night.
And JJ, all of whom are, not surprisingly, quite musical. Teresa has now worked for 14 years as a barrister with a base in the law library, in what would seem a world away from the bright lights of television entertainment.
The business about entertainment and the links with the law, I mean, back in the 18th century, the courts were theatre, pure theatre, and the spectators were coming from far and wide to see this battle of wits. That is, to a degree, the same today. News coverage is absolutely saturated with stories about the latest case, and an awful lot of what we see on television and here on radio is to do with crime, is to do with law. I think everybody finds it very interesting. In my own case, my practice is largely a criminal one. I specialise in high court bail, and I do a little bit of personal injury litigation as well, which is road traffic accidents and accidents in the workplace. I haven't reached the heights of Seamus Sorahan, but I've run some criminal trials, and I have to say, the first time that I addressed a jury, my voice wobbled, and it wasn't with nerves, it was pure emotion, because I was at last doing the thing I wanted to do for all those years, albeit it took a long, long time.
That's what they're playing for, and the very best of luck to both teams.
The winner of the John Player Tops for 1991.
I'm very glad that I took the scenic route in all of this. I wanted to do law from such a young age, but all of these other things intervened, and it's all experience of life, and I'm the sum of my experiences, and I think all of that has come together now. I wouldn't be without any of it, from the chalk ice machine, to the acting, to the portrait painting, to my 14 years of broadcasting with RTE, and now I'm in the job that I wanted to do all along. I find it challenging, rewarding, enjoyable, and I feel lucky to be doing something that I like.